In the last segment, I talked a bit more generally about the state variables of a dynamical system. The values of these variables, like the angles and angular velocities of the double pendulum, evolve continuously under the influence of the dynamics of the system. For example, gravity is acting on the double pendulum, but the constraints of the ball bearings, which only allow rotational motion, affect that dynamics as well. So what do you think the state variables would be for an elbow? An elbow, unless you're damaged, can only move in this direction. So you could fully describe the state of an elbow thinking about this angle and the rate of change of that angle. So the state space there would have two axes. What about a wrist? A wrist can move this way, or it can move that way. So we need two angles to describe its position, and two angular velocities to describe how it's moving. So the state space for a wrist would have four axes. What about a shoulder? A shoulder can move this way, or that way, or this way. So a shoulder has three state variables that describe the position and three that describe the velocity, and its state space would have six axes. The state space is arguably the most powerful of the many representations we use in the field of nonlinear dynamics. It suppresses time and brings out the patterns that emerge as the system evolves. So it's kind of like mounting a camera over that eddy in the stream that I used as an example before, opening the shutter, putting a wood chip in the eddy, letting it go around with the camera taking pictures the whole time, and then turning off the shutter of the camera. What the camera would have recorded is the path of the wood chip through the eddy. If you wanted to explore a wider expanse of the water, of the dynamical system, in the metaphor, you would want to repeat that experiment, dropping the wood chip in lots of different parts of the state space and seeing what happens. And that's the idea of a state space portrait of a dynamical system. You're picking initial conditions to explore that are interesting and representative of the dynamics of the whole system. And just like in a portrait that you would draw of a person's face, you have to focus your exploration. An artist will draw an eye very carefully, but he or she will not devote much work to the cheek. And we do that also with state space portraits. Let's draw one for the pendulum. As we established, the axes of the state space are theta, the angle, and omega, the angular velocity. The state space of the double pendulum would have four axes. That gets hard to draw. So this state of the system is 0, 0 on those axes. This state of the system is π0 on those axes, if I define angle positively in this direction. This state of the system would be -π0 on those axes. So if this is 0, 0, that state is 2π0. And that state is -2π0. Here's the pendulum against a better backdrop so that you can really see what's going on. And I wanted to circle back around to what I just said. If this is theta equals 0, this looks just like that to us. But if somebody's keeping track of how many times it's wound around the axis back here, that's actually a different angle. It's actually different by 2π. And if I have defined theta positive going this way, that's actually 2π. So here is theta equals 0, theta equals 2π, theta equals 4π, 2π, 0 again, and now -2π. There's a way of measuring angle that kind of discounts all of the times it's wound itself around the axis. You can use the mathematical modulo operator. You can divide the angle by 2 pi and only keep the fractional part. That is equivalent to measuring the angle the way we actually see it without keeping track of the winding up. This point here would be pi over 2, 0, but if I started it with a little bit of a push, that would be pi over 2, and then a small amount of velocity. The next question is, what is the sign of that velocity? Well, I defined angle positive going this way, so a velocity that is making the angle go that way is a negative velocity. So, you get the idea. Now, those were all thought experiments about states at specific points in time. Now, let's think about how the state evolves. First of all, most of the examples that we just went through involve fixed points of the dynamics. So this point right here is a fixed point of the dynamics. You put the system there, it doesn't move. It's a stable fixed point because if I deliver a small perturbation, that perturbation shrinks over time. The point negative 2 pi 0 is also a stable fixed point. The point 2 pi 0 is a stable fixed point. So the points at even multiples of pi are stable fixed points. The points at odd multiples of pi are unstable fixed points. This one I think I can get to balance. There is a fixed point of this dynamics. It is unstable. So that's one. There's another one here. There's another one here. There's another one here. So how many unstable fixed points do you think this device has? An infinite number. Same thing for stable fixed points. Here are some of the stable fixed points in blue, and here are some of the unstable fixed points in red at the odd multiples of pi. So that means we're done with some of the portrait, all those points on the theta axis that I just drew. Now we need to explore some of the other points. So let's look at this one. What does that trajectory look like in the state space representation? Like an ellipse, actually, if the angle is small enough. We'll get back to the exact form of the curve in the next two segments of this unit. All right, let's try a slightly larger initial condition. That's a bigger ellipse in the state space. For even larger theta, those ellipses deform into rugby balls. We'll get back to the mathematics of that when we study ordinary differential equations later in this unit. What about this one? What does that look like on the state space portrait? To understand this, think about the fact that the pendulum slows down every time it goes over the top and speeds up every time it goes past the bottom. Or this one. In one of these trajectories, theta is winding itself up. It keeps getting more and more positive because the velocity is positive. In the other, theta keeps getting smaller because the velocity is negative. Something interesting happens in between these closed curves and these so-called running solutions, and that interesting thing involves the unstable fixed points. We'll talk about that at the beginning of Unit 4. In the meantime, here's our portrait. I've added a few things. The behavior is the same around the 2 pi fixed point as the 0 pi fixed point as the 4 pi fixed point. I've also added some faster running solutions. If I push the pendulum faster over the top, it would spin faster, which is why those curves are further out the omega axis, and it would slow down less over the top, so the wiggles are supposed to be drawn a little bit less wiggly. And this portrait was our goal for today. Two important points here. First of all, as some of you have probably noticed, the portrait that we just drew is actually not representative of this particular device because this particular device has friction. It's going through a damped oscillation to a fixed point. The portrait I drew assumes no friction. With no friction, there's no attractors because there's nothing causing the transient to die out, nothing causing the trajectory to converge to anything. So the fixed points in the portrait that we drew are actually not technically attracting fixed points. A system without friction is called a conservative system or a Hamiltonian system. That's a synonym for it doesn't have any dissipation or friction. And the points at 0, 2 pi, 4 pi, negative 2 pi are called elliptic fixed points, and that's because of those ellipses around them. All that is a little bit beyond our scope in this course. Another important point, uniqueness. Notice that the trajectories in our picture don't cross. In fact, that's a mathematical requirement. As you'll see in the next segments, you can think of a trajectory as a ball rolling downhill on a landscape defined by a dynamics. And the kind of systems that we'll play with, there's only one direction that's dynamically downhill, unless someone is moving the landscape underneath you. More on that a little bit later.